Hello everyone, now we are going to see the network layer performance. Okay, so the performance of this particular network, it is also measured in terms of delay or throughput or packet loss, and later we will see about congestion control. So it is measured through delay, throughput and packet loss. Okay, so delay, it is nothing but always whenever we are sending a packet from the sender to receiver, there will be an instantaneous delay will happen. So delay can also be divided into four types. One will be a transmission delay. The second one is propagation delay. And third one is processing delay. And fourth is queuing delay. So we are going to see all these delay now. Then after which we are going for throughput. So first we will see on the transmission delay. So whenever a packet sent from the source to destination, it encounters delay. Okay, this is what the delay is. So the first delay we are going to see is transmission delay. So what is transmission delay? So whenever a sender, if he wants to send a packet, so first he will put the packet one, that is like bit one in online, put this bit one on bit in the online. The next, he will put the second bit on the line. Okay, likewise, he'll be putting all the bits. So there will be a transmission delay. This is the there will be a delay. Suppose, for example, a bit 1 has been put into this packet at time T1 and the bit 2 is put at time T2. Likewise, there will be a transmission delay between putting this bits into this packet, or otherwise it is on the line. So this is called as transmission delay. So what we say transmission delay is nothing but time it takes for a frame or a packet, for a packet of average size to be sent out. So what is the time required for sending the packet of average size to be sent out from the sender? We can say it is called transmission delay. So I'll repeat. So whenever you are going to put the bits into the packet, there will be a transmission delay. So this transmission delay can be calculated using the formula, the packet length, how many bits you have in the packet, that divided by the transmission rate will give you the transmission delay. So for example, now we will see an example for this. So in this example, you think that there is in a fast Ethernet LAN, so the bit has been, that is like packet has been sent with a transmission rate of 100 million bits per second, and the packet length is 10,000 bits. So as it is in this particular formula, we can use this and we can find out the transmission delay. So transmission delay will be packet length divided by transmission rate. So the packet length is 10,000 over here, that divided by the transmission rate 100 million per second. So we have written in zeros with help. Then we will get, when we divide this, we will get it is nothing but 100 microsecond. So this is what the answer we will get. So like this, you have to calculate your transmission delay. So when transmission rate and packet length is given, we can able to find out the transmission delay. Next is propagation delay. Propagation delay is nothing but a time it requires. So you have a source and you here you have the destination. Whenever you are going to send the packet, so the time it requires for a bit to travel from the source to destination inside the media is called as a propagation delay. So you can say it is a time it takes for a bit to travel from source to destination in the media, you can say it is called propagation delay. So we can calculate propagation delay with the formula distance divided by propagation speed. So in this example, so they have given the distance of a cable is 2000 meters. It is like from the sender to receiver, you have a cable, that is propagation media. The distance is 2000 meters, and the speed of the propagation speed of the inside the cable is 2 × 10⁸ meter per second. So we can find out this propagation delay, which is represented by dpg, that will be 2000 / 2 × 10⁸. We will get 10 microseconds. So this is how you have to calculate your propagation delay. So this transmission delay is represented by DTR and propagation delay is represented by DPG. The delay is processing delay. Processing delay is nothing but the time required for a router to process the packet. So what it has to do is that it has to remove the header and it has to perform some error detection procedure and deliver the packet to the output port, that is like deliver the packet to the upper layer protocol. That is done in your router. So this delay is called processing delay. So we can say that the time required to process the packet in a router is called processing delay. So whenever a packet reaches a router, what this router has to do, it has to perform, remove the header. First it has to remove the header and it has to perform error detection procedure. If it requires any error detection procedure has to be performed, and it delivers the packet to the upper layer. Okay, the processing involved, the time involved in doing all this process is called your processing delay. So there is no formula, just that it's a time. So it is measured by the time, how much time it takes for processing the packet inside your router. We can say it is called the processing delay. So delay is queuing delay. Queuing delay, it also happens in a router. So whenever a packet reaches a router, so router, if it is having too much of packet, it will have an input queue, and where all the packets has to wait inside the queue, and it will be also having an output queue for sending the packets. So the time the packet waits inside this input queue or output queue, we can say it is called your queuing delay. So the router, when it is having an input queue, so and it is having output queue, the time it has to wait inside this input queue or output queue before going for processing inside your router, this time we can call it as a queuing delay. We will calculate the total delay of the network. So assume that we know the number of routers inside your network. Suppose you have the source and here you have the destination, and you have the routers R1, R2 and R3. Before it reaches a packet, before a packet sends from the source and destination, it has to pass through the router R1, R2 and R3. If we know the number of routers between source and destination, we can easily find out the total delay. Okay, so if we have n routers, so for example, if we have n routers, then there will be n plus 1 transmission delay, that is represented as transmission delay, that is represented as delay TR, and n plus 1 propagation delay, since there will be, if there are n routers, there will be n plus 1 link. So there will be n plus 1 transmission delay, n plus 1 processing delay, that is represented by DT, delay PG, and the n plus 1 processing delay, that is represented by delay PR, and there will be n queuing delay. So if there are n routers and there will be n plus 1 links. Suppose if here you have 3 routers, so how many links are there? 1, 2, 3, 4 links are there. So how will you find all this delay? So the processing transmission delay will happen here, here and here and here and also here. So total how many delays is there? N plus 1. So it will be n plus 1 transmission delay. Propagation delay will also happen in each place, so it is n plus 1. Processing delay will also happen in all the place, so it is n plus 1. And there will be n queuing delay, because the delay will happen only in the router side. So there is only n number of routers, so it will be n. So we can calculate total delay will be, so n plus 1, we can take this n plus 1 in common for all the three delays. N plus 1 into transmission delay plus propagation delay plus processing delay plus n into the queuing delay, we can easily find out the total delay of the network. Okay, so in this we have seen the network layer performance. So first we have discussed on delay. Every packet when it is sent from source to destination, it will encounter a delay. So there are 4 types of delays. So that is what we have seen: transmission delay, propagation delay, then we have seen a processing delay and queuing delay. At last we have found out the total delay of the network. Okay, next we are going to see the throughput of the network. Next, the network performance is measured by throughput. Okay, what is a throughput? Throughput is nothing but the number of bits passing through a point in a second is called a throughput. So number of bits passing through the point In a second is called a throughput, which is actually called, you can say it is called the transmission rate of data. Okay, usually in the part there will be several links will be available. So each will be having a different transmission rate. In that case, how will you identify this? How will you differentiate this throughput? So we will see a scenario in this between source and destination. We have three links. One link which is having a transmission rate 200 kbps, and here you have a router. Router has to queue, it will have a queue, so it is again sending with a transmission rate, lesser transmission rate than before, so it is 100 kbps. And again we have a router R2, and it is spending with the next higher transmission rate with 150 kbps. So we have three different transmission rate between source and destination. So in that case, how will you identify this, or will you measure the throughput? So in this case, throughput will be measured by the minimum of all the transmission rate. So minimum one, we are transmitting at 200, other 100 and 150. The minimum of transmission rate is 100. The throughput of this particular network is 100 kbps. Okay. So we will also simulate this particular example with a diagram where you have here, you have the router. The link between the source and router is shown over here with this, simulated over here in this diagram. And you have the link between R1 and R2, which is been sent with 100 kbps speed. So it is spent with, it has been reduced its diameter. And again, it is sending with at 150 kbps. So in this case, the throughput will be the minimum of the minimum of all the transmission rate can be taken as your throughput. So we can say throughput is minimum of TR1, TR2 and TRN. Okay, this is how you can calculate your throughput. Next one is packet loss. So coming to this packet loss, another major issue that is which will affect the performance of the network is packet loss. So packet loss is nothing but number of packets lost during the transmission. Number of packets lost during transmission, we can say it is called packet loss. So how this happens when a router receives a packet? Okay, when a router thinks that it is already processing a packet, and when it receives another packet, called P2, what it does is, since it is processing P1, it will loses the packet P2. Okay, this will also occur. In some cases, it will also have a queue where this queue, it will have all the incoming packets will be placed inside your input queue. So in some cases where this queue itself will become full, in that case, when any packet comes to this router, this packet will get lost. So these are the losses happens during your transmission. This is also one of the major issue which will affect the performance of the network. Okay, there are three parameter which will affect. One is delay, the second one we have seen is throughput, and third is packet loss. We'll see the congestion control. Coming to this congestion control, it will improve the performance of the network. Okay, we will see how it is improving the performance. So usually what we can do is that we can either prevent this congestion before it happens, or we can remove the congestion. This is what the two techniques we can follow for preventing the congestion or removing the congestion after it happened. So we can divide it based on this. We can divide it into two types. One is open loop congestion, other one is closed loop congestion. In open loop congestion, we can call it as a prevention of congestion. And closed loop congestion, we can say it is the removal. So we are removing the congestion after this congestion has occurred. We will see these two techniques one by one. So next we are going to see the open loop congestion control. So what is this open loop congestion control is? So here we are going to give some policies so that we are going to prevent the congestion. So we are going to use some mechanisms or techniques to prevent the congestion before it happens is called open loop congestion control. So what are the policies we can apply? So there are five policies we can apply. One is retransmission, window policy, acknowledgement policy, discarding policy and admission policy. First we will see the retransmission policy. Coming to this retransmission, it is usually unavoidable. So whenever a packet has been lost or it has been corrupted, we need to send the packet again. Retransmission is there. So when retransmission is there, then there occurs the congestion. Okay, so what we have to do is that to prevent the congestion, so we need to form some retransmission policies, and also we need to use some timers, retransmission timers. So this will avoid, or this will prevent the timers, which will prevent the congestion before it happens. This is what we can do it in retransmission policy. So framing some policies and we are using some timers, you can prevent the congestion. The second is window policy. Coming to the window, the type of the window will also cause, type of the window will also cause the congestion. So there are two types of windows or there. One will be selective repeat window. Selective repeat window. The second one is go back n window. Okay, so there are two types of windows you can use while you're sending the packets. First, coming to selective repeat window. So here what we do is we will send only the specific packets which has been lost or corrupted. So instead of sending all the packets for retransmission, we will send only the selective packets. So which will reduce the congestion, which will avoid retransmission also, selective packets. So this is what your selective repeat window. Next is go back n window, where we will be sending all the packets when any corruption or lost has been occurred in once. When you are going to send one set of packets, any one of the packet goes wrong or goes lost, you are going to send entire set of packets for retransmission. This is go back n window. So here we are going to follow only selective repeat window, where you are going to send only the selective packets for retransmission, which will prevent the congestion also. This is your window policy. Next one is acknowledgement policy. Coming to acknowledgement policy, if the receiver does not acknowledge every packet it receives, it may also slow down the sender. So which will also prevent, which will help to prevent congestion. So what we will do in this acknowledgement policy is, so instead of sending, the acknowledgement can be sent for n packets instead of one packet. So what do you mean by this is that in acknowledgement policy, what we'll do is that, so whenever a packet has been sent, for every packet, instead of sending the acknowledgement, we will send one acknowledgement for n packets. So if you are sending like this, we are going to reduce the acknowledgement packets, which will in turn reduce the which will prevent congestion also. This is your congestion policy, acknowledgement policy. To discarding policy. In discarding policy, which will be used in audio transmission. So what we'll do is that, so while you're transmitting your audio file, so we will discard all your less sensitive packets. Okay. So less sensitive packet, we will discard. So instead of, because of discarding all this less sensitive packet, the congestion will be reduced. So even without the help of less sensitive packets, your quality of the sound is still preserved. So discarding all your less sensitive packets will reduce the congestion or prevent the congestion. This is your discarding policy. And what is admission policy? Admission policy, what it will do is the router, it will deny, that is like if while it is accepting the packets itself, while it is admitting the packets itself, it will check whether this packet will induce any congestion inside the network. If it induces congestion, then it will avoid that particular packet to be sent out inside the router. That is your admission policy. So what it will do, the router will deny that particular packet if the router thinks that particular packet will increase it will increase the congestion, then it will avoid that particular packet to be admitted. That is your admission policy. So there are five types of policies in your open loop congestion control for preventing retransmission: window, acknowledgement, discarding, and admission policy. Next, we are going to see the closed loop congestion control. So here we are going to remove the congestion after that congestion has occurred. Okay. So how we are going to do is that by two ways. One is back pressure. The second one is choke packet. Okay, the first one is back pressure. So what back pressure will do is that we will see with this example, you have a source and you have a destination and you have routers R1, R2, R3 and R4 in between source and destination. If router R3 in this a congestion occurred, so what this router R3 will do is that it will send a packet called back pressure. It will send a packet, special packet to router R2 to slow down its input process, and in which in turn which will be sending it to the router R1, which in turn the pressure is sent it to the source. So here the back pressure, the pressure has been moved back to the source to remove the congestion. So this is called your back pressure. So what it does is that it is here, this can be applied only with virtual circuits, because every node will know the path. So what happens is that this will occur only in virtual circuit approach, where every node will know the path before establishing the, before transmitting the data. So if any congestion is going to happen in the router R3, will send the information to the router R2 and R1, which in turn which will be send it to the source to reduce, to reduce the input flow, which the back pressure has been moved, pressure has been moved to the source to reduce the congestion. So this is what happens in back pressure. Next one is choke packet. In closed loop congestion control, the second process choke packet. So here whenever a congestion occurred in router R3, instead of sending the warning from 3 to 1, it will send directly to the source station. So here a special packet will be designed, it is called a choke packet. This choke packet will be sent from the router R3 directly to the source to reduce the congestion. It will reduce the input flow. So this is called choke packet. The main difference between back pressure and choke packet is, in back pressure, a warning message will be sent from 3 to 1 and then it will be reaches the source. But here the packet will be designed, a special packet called choke packet. It will be sent directly to the source. This is the main difference between the back pressure and choke packet. Okay. Next two process you have is implicit signaling and explicit signaling. First coming to implicit signaling. In implicit signaling, there is no communication between the congested packet and also the source. Congested packet and source. So what happens is that, suppose when a source wants to, when a source sends some packets to the destination, so it will wait for the acknowledgement, okay, that the source will wait for the acknowledgement to receive. But if the acknowledgement has been delayed, so if it has not been reached in particular time, the source thinks that there is a congestion occurred in the destination side, so it automatically, it will slow down its process. This is called as implicit signaling. Implicit signaling means without any communication or without sending any packet, by itself the source will understand that there is a congestion occurred in the destination side, it will slow down its input process. So this process is called as implicit signaling. Then what is explicit signaling? In explicit signaling, this is also different from the choke packet. So what the destination will do is, while it is sending the packet, suppose source is sending a packet, so while it is sending the acknowledgement, this destination will send a signal along with the data. It will also send along with the data, this signal will also be sent to the source to explicitly slow down its process. This is called explicit signaling. So where in case of choke packet, a packet is designed and it has been sent from the congested node to the source. But here the packet is not been sent, it has been sent as a signal along with the data. It will be sent from the destination where a congestion has been occurred. It will be sent to source to reduce this congestion. So this is what we have in our closed loop congestion control. So congestion control is of two types, open loop congestion control and closed loop. In open loop congestion control, we have seen 5 different policies. In closed loop, back pressure is there where the pressure is moved towards the source, and we have a choke packet where the packet, special packet will be sent. And last is implicit signaling and explicit signaling. Okay, thank you.